study more properties of rings today, but I want to start with some revision of the group theory that you have learned. Why? Because we are going to study somewhat similar systems for rings, and also we are going to use the results in the group theory. So let us quickly revise. If G is a group and H is a subgroup of G, you know how to make the set of cosets of H. If the binary operation is written as addition, then the cosets are x plus h for every x in G. And you know that these cosets are mutually disjoint, and they also have a binary operation which is induced from the operation of G. If the operation is plus in G, then you can define the binary operation on the cosets as x plus y plus h. But under this binary operation is the set of cosets, namely G by H, a group? It is not always so. But if H is a normal subgroup, if H is a normal subgroup of G, then you know that G by H, that is the set of cosets, becomes a group under this operation of addition, which is induced from the binary operation of addition on G. Now, let us carry similar ideas to a ring R. We know that a subset S contained in R is called a subring if S itself is a ring. Also, because R has got two binary operations, plus and multiplication, we expect richer structure and more theorems. So, for given a subring of R, namely S, can we form cosets of S? Surely, we can find the cosets as x plus s, the set x plus s, where x is in R. Now, we are in the structure of a ring. So, if we find the set of cosets like this, can we define the operations of addition and multiplication on these cosets? And when will this set of cosets become a ring itself? So, this is the object of our study today. Let us see what happens to these cosets. Now, I am going to define a new idea. It is called an ideal of R. Let us define it, and we will see that the ideals are the special subrings, so that the quotient or the set of cosets will form a ring. Let us define. A subring S of ring R is called an ideal if for any R in R, the multiplication R S is also contained in S. What does that mean? It means that S is closed under multiplication by elements in R. So, what are the conditions on S? S is first of all a subring, and for any little r in R, RS will be contained in S. So the same definition can also be written as S contained in R is an ideal. We will say two-sided ideal if RS and SR both are contained in S. Both are contained in S. Yes. Let us define. If for S1, S2 in S, S1 minus S2 is also in S. That takes care of the fact that S is a additive subgroup. And then for instead of being closed for multiplication with elements in S, for any element little r of R and S in S, RS and SR are also contained in S. And here we are going to define a two-sided ideal. Why? Because we are considering multiplication by R on left as well as on right. And for us, the rings will be commutative, so the word two-sided is not really needed. So an ideal is a special subring. And now with this definition of ideal, we will show that the cosets of an ideal in a ring will form a ring itself. And what will be the operations? See, if we want R by S to be a ring, we need two operations, addition and multiplication. And how do we define them now? So if X is an ideal, addition will be defined as this, and multiplication will be defined as this, is equal to XY of S. Now, we have defined them all right, but we have to check that the definition is justified, that these operations are well defined. How do you check that? We need to check that these operations are independent of the representatives chosen, because the coset x plus s can also be defined as some x prime plus s. So we have to check that these operations are well defined. Let us check that. If x1 plus s is also equal to x2 plus s and y1 plus s is equal to y2 plus s, then we need to show that the addition x1 plus s plus y1 plus s is same as x2 plus s plus y2 plus s, and the multiplication x1 by 1 s is also equal to x1 by 1 plus s, it has to be, is equal to x2 y2 plus s. The first one is rather easy, because x1 plus s is equal to x2 plus s. What does that mean? That x1 is equal to x2 plus some little s, where s is in S. And also y1 is equal to y2 plus a little t, where t is also in S. So naturally, you check this, that x1 plus y1 plus s is equal to x2 plus y2 plus s plus t. But s plus t are already contained in S, which is a subgroup, additive subgroup. So this is nothing but x2 plus y2 plus s. So that was rather easy. Let us check the multiplication. And there you will see that we need to use the special property of the subring, namely it is closed under multiplication by elements of R. Let us check that. If x1, I am sorry, this has to be plus. Because we are considering the additive group and the posex of the additive. Okay, so x1 plus s again is equal to x2 plus s, y1 plus s is equal to y2 plus s. Now, x1 y1 plus s is equal to therefore, again x1 is equal to x2 plus s, y1 is equal to y2 plus t, the same substitution we take. So, this will be x2 plus s into y2 plus t plus capital S again. So, what do we get? So, this is equal to x2 y2 plus, now this is x2 t plus s y2 plus s t plus s. Now, because s is closed for multiplication by any element in R, and these s and these x2 and y2 are any elements in R. Therefore, this is equal to x2 y2 plus s. So, this is also in s, this is also in s, all the elements are in s, and therefore, the coset is the same as s. So, the multiplication, the binary operation of multiplication is well defined because of the new condition that we introduce for s. Okay. Let us now look at some examples, because whenever you see any new definition, looking at lots of examples makes the definition more clear and then you can work with it. Let us look at the simple examples that you already know. We are going to consider mostly commutative rings with unity. So, let us see Z. What are the subrings of Z? I asked you to check that the subrings of Z are precisely nZ for any integer n. To prove this, you have to use the well ordering principle. Now, are the subrings also ideals? Yes. Then each nz is also an ideal in Z. Why? Because if S is in nz, then RS is also in NZ for any R in Z. That is the extra condition for the ideal. Because S is in NZ means S is a multiple of N. So, if you further multiply S by R, it is still a multiple of N and it is a member of Z. Therefore, this all the rings in Z are ideals, but that doesn't happen in every case. That does not happen for all the rings. Let us look at some more rings. Then you will see that you can have different examples giving different subrings and ideals. Let us check. Let R be a commutative ring. R is a commutative ring with unity. Then consider the set generated by an element A in R. So, how do you define that? The ideal generated by A will be this where R is in R. Shall we check that this is first of all a subring? That is easy to check. That is easy to check because R A plus minus S A is equal to R plus minus S into A, and this is in the set generated by S A. And also consider any R A in A, then you have S R A is also in A. Therefore, it is closed under multiplication by general elements in R, and you can check that this is indeed an ideal. And remember, R is a commutative ring with unity. Therefore, trivially for any integer A, n A is also in A. Remember this. So, just n copies of A added together will also be in A. Why? Because one is in R, therefore all positive integers are also in R. So this is a commutative ring, and under our notation this will be the ideal generated by an element in A. So this is another example of how we can construct an ideal. Suppose we have got in the same row, if we have got elements A1, A2, AK. If A1, A2, AK are elements, then in R, then this will be the ring generated by, and if the general members will be R1, A1 plus R2, A2 plus RK, AK, where all these RI are. This is also a ring, and that is generated by the elements A1, A2, AK. Let RX be the next ring that we want to consider. What is that? These are the set of polynomials in X with coefficients in R. Okay. You know that this is also a ring under usual addition and multiplication. R is commutative with unity. Then consider the ideal generated by X. What will that be? Ideal generated by X in Rx now. So this will be fx into x for any fx in Rx. So can you see, can you describe the ideal in another way? Can you do that? You can. It also means the polynomials fx equal to a0 plus a1x plus an x raised to n, where a0 is 0. So, the polynomial will be expressed as something that starts with x, then a to x plus a n x raise to n. So this can be expressed as the polynomial with the constant term 0, because if the constant term is 0, surely you can express this as x into another polynomial, and it will be the same set as the ideal generated by x. Consider again Zx as the ring of all polynomials. In the same thing, we are going to consider the ring of polynomials with coefficients in integers. Zx, polynomials with coefficients in the set of integers. And what is the ideal that we want to consider? I is the set of ideals, set of polynomials with the constant term even. With the constant term and even integer. Now, is this first of all a subring? Yes. Is it an ideal? Yes. Because if the constant term is even, then the multiplication by any other polynomial will also produce a constant term which is even. And also two even integers added or subtracted give you an even integer. So, clearly I is first of all a subring, and then it is also an ideal. Later on you will realize that I is not generated by a single polynomial. Like this ideal is generated by x, I is not generated by a single polynomial, but you can express I as a polynomial generated by two elements, x and 2, the constant term 2, both are in Zx. And these two elements generate this particular ideal. Okay. The next example also gives you a case where a subring may not be an ideal. So, what is the next example? All real valued functions, it is the set of all real valued functions on R, the set of real numbers. Then what do we want? S. S is equal to set of all differentiable functions. Is it a subring? Yes, it is a subring, because S is closed under addition, subtraction and multiplication by elements in S. But S is not an ideal. S is not an ideal. Why? Because if f is not differentiable, in fact it may not even be continuous, differentiable, if f is not differentiable, then f into s is not contained in s. Because if you consider the product of two functions, one is differentiable and the other is not, then the product is not differentiable. So, you can certainly have subrings which are not ideals. In fact, you can construct your own. if you think of matrices in particular, you will get lots more examples where there are subrings which are not ideals. You will come across them in the exercises also, or you can construct them yourselves. Now we are considering the factoring by an ideal, and here is a nice theorem. We have already proved that for an ideal I, R by I is a ring. So let me just state the theorem. And we have proved half of it, we'll prove the other. R is a ring and a subring of R. This is the theorem on page 250. This is the theorem on page 250 of the book that we are following. The set of cosets R plus A, where R is in R, is a ring under the operations C. If you want to define a ring, you have to define two binary operations, that is our definitions. And what are the operations now? R plus A plus S plus A, the addition is R plus S plus A. Oh, he's using slightly different notation, S and T, but doesn't matter. S plus A into T plus A will be equal to ST plus A. We have already proved one part, that is, if A is an ideal, if and only if, I forgot to say, the total statement is like this, only if A is an ideal, and we mean a two-sided ideal. So we have proved one part. What is that? If A is an ideal, then R by A is a ring under these operations. We have already proved it. Let us now prove the second part, namely that if the set of cosets is a ring, then A has to be an ideal, not just a subring, but it has actually got to be an ideal. So what do we want to show? We want to show that A is closed under multiplication by elements in S. We prove that if R by A is a ring, then A is an ideal. For that, what do we want to show? We want to show that for any R in A, so what is it that we want to show? That R into A is contained in A for every R in R. So let us consider two elements, R plus A and just A, and A is also 0 plus A, by the way. Okay. So consider the multiplication. What is that? R plus A into 0 plus A will be, by definition, 0 plus A equal to A. But what does that mean? Expand this and what do you get? What you get is multiply this R into A plus A into A. It is closed under multiplication by elements in A itself. So this is contained in A, which implies that A is an ideal. All we needed to show was that RA is contained in A, and this is how we need to show. You can have it multiplication on the left or on the right, but A is closed under multiplication by elements in R, and therefore A is an ideal. Let us now look at some more examples that you have already studied in different contexts. Okay, consider now Z by 4Z, and we will land into the rings that you have studied. We know that 4Z is an ideal contained in Z. So what will be the cosets? The cosets are 0 plus 4Z, that is 4Z itself, 1 plus 4Z, 2 plus 4Z, and 3 plus 4Z. So this is precisely equal to Z4 in our notation. When you study integers modulo 4, you get exactly 4 cosets, namely 0 bar, 1 bar, 2 bar, and 3 bar. So the ring that you are familiar with arises as a quotient by an ideal. And similarly, you can study others. What is more, the next example given is 2z quotient 6z. So what will be the elements? The elements are 0 plus 6z. Okay. Then 2 plus 6z and 4 plus 6z. Any even integer modulo 6z will be either 0, 2 or 4, and it has got exactly 3 elements, and this also is, as you can notice, is isomorphic with Z3, coset of 0 bar, 1 bar and 2 bar in Z3. Just divide by 2 each coset, and this is like Z3 itself. So, we have already been studying quotient rings, quotient being taken by an ideal. I just want to check, we have also studied something, another example. What is that? 0 bar, 2 bar and 4 bar. This is contained in Z6 independently. We had studied it independently, and this is exactly the same here, and we have seen that this is a subring and 4 bar is a multiplicative identity, it is the unity, and it is precisely the same ring as we now see in 2Z by 6Z. Let us now turn to matrices. That's what I said. In matrices, you will have lots more examples. The notation is M2, 2 by 2 matrices with coefficients or elements in Z. So what will they be? Matrices A, B, C, D with A, B, C, D in Z. We are familiar with this. Now, I is the subset of matrices where the elements are even. A, B, C, D in now 2Z. Now, is this an ideal? Very clearly it is a subring and it is also an ideal. You can check that. Now, what is the quotient? What is the quotient of this? By I. You have to reduce every matrix by matrix with even entries, and what do you get? You get exactly 8 elements. What will they be? A, B, C, D, with A, B, C, D having only 2 choices, 0 or 1. Why? Because as soon as there is an integer bigger than 1, you can reduce it by an element in I. Let us just check. Let us just check with an example. It will be more clear then. Just take any 2 by 2 matrix with any entries that you can think of. 7, 4, minus 3, 1. Okay? This is a general matrix in M2Z. But if I subtract from it 6, 4, minus 4, I am going to subtract minus 4, so it will reduce to 1, and then 0. Then what do I get? Remember, the subtraction is each component or each element wise. So you get 1, 0, 1, and 1. So the entries are only 1 or 0. And this matrix is certainly in the ideal. So every matrix you can reduce it by a matrix with even entries into a matrix with entries only 0 or 1. And therefore, what is the order of this? What is the order of this quotient by I? How many elements? 2 possibilities for each element. So, there will be exactly 16 elements. So, that is a ring, a quotient ring. Quotient is taken by an ideal. And the number of elements is exactly 16 here. Original ring is infinite. The ideal is also infinite. And the quotient ring is finite. Same happened for Z by 2Z, Z by 6Z. The quotient rings are finite there. Not always though, the quotient rings can also be infinite, but here we have found all the finite. Okay, now there is another interesting example. It's very interesting. Why? Because the result is rather surprising. Now, our ring is Gaussian. What is that again? It is A plus B I. I is the usual I square equal to minus 1, where A and B are in Z. And what is the ideal that we want to consider? It is the ideal generated by a single element 2 minus I. See, we saw an ideal generated by a single element A. Now, this element A is for us 2 minus I. So, what do we have? We want to take a quotient by, consider now R by I. So, any element A plus B I, we need to reduce by a multiple of 2 minus I. Multiple, how do you take the multiple? Multiple of this with the factor or the multiplier in ZI again, in R. This also gives me that if, now, in this quotient, what will be 2 minus I? 2 minus I will be 0, isn't it? When you take quotient by this ideal and you know that this element is in the ideal, so this is in the quotient, this will reduce to 0. Or in other words, 2 and I will be equivalent and I square will be equal to minus 4 because I square is minus 1. But I also know that I square is equal to 4, but I also know that I square is equal to minus 1. See, I is equal to 2, therefore I square is equal to 4. I also know that I square is equal to minus 1. So what do I get? I get the relation that 5 is equal to 0. Take 1 to the other side. And so in the quotient, remember, not in Zi, but in the quotient, the 5 reduces to 0. So what will the elements look like? All the elements now are reduced with the ideal generated by 2 minus I, and then the number 5 is equal to 0. What will the general elements now look like? I want to take any element a plus bi and also use the relation that I is equal to 2, 5 is equal to 0, what do I get? This is equal to, in the quotient mind you, not in the usual form, I would rather put a bar because I am taking the quotient so as to avoid confusion. I would rather write like this, a plus b bar in the quotient is a plus 2b. And I also remember that 5 is equal to 0. So this a plus 2b will be equal to either, see, first I reduced the element to an integer, coset of an integer. Besides, I also know that 5 is going to reduce to 0. So this will be identical to the coset 1 bar, 2 bar, 3 bar, 4 bar or 0 bar, and they will be in Z5. Do you see what is happening here? Zi is an infinite ring. It is the set of Gaussian integers. Consider the ideal generated by 2 minus I and take the quotient. In the quotient, elements in I are mapped onto 0. Therefore, I reduces to 2. Not only that, but I also know I square is equal to minus 1, so the integer 5 reduces to 0. Therefore, the quotient ring has at most 5 elements, 5 or 1, isn't it? Because the quotient ring is a finite ring now, and what will be the number of elements? It can't be just 1. Why? Because if it is only one element, if R by I has only one element, why do I say that the elements are either 1 or 5? Because I know that 5 times unity is going to be 0. So the characteristic is either 1 or 5. See, the characteristic divides the multiplier of 1 bar which reduces to 0. What is the characteristic in a finite ring? The least positive integer that annihilates 1, the unity. 5 into 1 is 0 here, I know. So the characteristic is only 1 or 5. But if this has only one element, then 2 bar, 3 bar, all are going to be equal to 1. But that is not true. That is not true. Therefore, there are 5 different elements and we must have this characteristic to be equal to 5. Why? If this is equal to 1, then this 2b plus a will be congruent to 1. But that is, all these are equal. then this is equal to 1, and that therefore I must write this. If you consider the coset of 1, consider this, and subtract 5 plus 2 minus I, if this is going to be equal to 0, we get a contradiction, because suppose there is only one coset, namely 0, then this will be equal to 0 plus 2 minus I. Okay. So we have 1 is equal to 2 minus I into A plus B I, that is the multiplier. I think I am making a mess of this. You need to be a little more careful. Let us just follow his argument. Although the argument is quite clear, because it has already got 5 elements, we only have to show that they have got 5 different elements. Okay, let us write this. Since so this is the coset, 5 times this coset is equal to 5 plus the coset 2 minus I, and this is equal to 0 plus 2 minus I. So we have shown that the order of is 5, so R by I is equal to 1 or 5. We just have to show that it is not equal to 1. Let us just check this. If the order is 1, then 1 plus this ideal will imply that this is equal to 1 plus zero plus 2 plus I. Yes, they both will be. Okay. If there is only one coset, then that coset has to be 0 plus 2 plus 2 minus I, and that we will give a contradiction. How do we get the contradiction? A plus, what is the general element in 2 minus I? 2 minus I into A1 plus I D1 will be equal to A2 plus I D2 into again 2 minus I. And we will run into a contradiction. How do we run into a contradiction? 1 plus, this gives me 2A1 plus B1 minus or plus I into 2B1 minus A1 is equal to 2A2 plus B2, because this is 2 minus I, and plus I into 2B2 minus A. So what do we get? These two are going to be equal, and these two are going to be equal. So what do we get? So we get one is equal to 2A plus B, and 0 is equal to minus A. Oh, these are the different numbers, sorry. Just take from this side, A2 minus A1 plus B2 minus B1, and these two are equal. So what does that give you? Twice B1 minus A1 is equal to twice B2 minus A1. And this will land into a contradiction, because all these are integers, times b1 minus b2 is equal to a1. Substitute here. So what do we get? B1 minus a1 minus a2 is 2 times. So 1 is equal to 4 times b1 plus b2 minus b1 is equal to 4 times b2 minus b1. 5 times. And this should happen for any given b2. So this will land us into a contradiction. If b2 minus b1 is equal to 1, this gives contradiction. Okay. This a1 and b1 and a2 and b2 are any integers. If I choose b1 such that this is b2 minus b1 is equal to 1, then this gives me contradiction because 1 upon 5 is not in our region. Not in our data at all. So it can't be in the picture. But there must be an easier way to show that the characteristic is not 0, because if the characteristic is 0, then what happens if r by I has got a single? See, there is a much easier way. If r by I is equal to single element 0 bar, this happens if and only if I is equal to r. And that is not so. That is not so. And this is much easier to check. Because if the quotient is a single element, then the ideal will have to be the whole of R, and that is not the case. You just have to check that the whole of Zi is not spanned as an ideal generated by 2 minus I. We will do that and we will check that this is a also lands us to the same conclusion that R by I is not a single element. I can leave that as an exercise. Check that. Okay. Let us now go ahead and look at another example. This is also with the polynomials, and this is what you have been studying before. What are we doing now? We are studying again the ring R of polynomials over Z. Polynomials with coefficients in Z. And what is the ideal? The one that is generated by x square plus 1. Consider the ideal generated by x square plus 1. So what will that be? The general elements will be fx into x square plus 1 for any fx in our ring R. Is it a subring? Yes. It is in fact an ideal. It is ideal generated by this. So consider R by I. What do you do? What do you do? Actually, what you do here, you have been doing before, because this is a polynomial with leading coefficient 1, and you can just remind yourself that if fx is an element in zx, then there exists a gx and rx in zx with degree of Rx to be less than or equal to 1. Sorry. Ha. half with fx equal to gx into x square plus 1 plus rx. What am I doing here? I am dividing the fx with x square plus 1 by the usual division, and I can write fx as the division algorithm, some polynomial gx multiplied by x square plus 1 plus rx, where the degree of rx is less than or equal to 1. This division you have been doing before, but now we consider the same division as an element in our quotient. So, what will we have? So, fx bar is equal to rx bar in r by r. We are reducing fx by an element in I. What is that element? That element is a multiple of x square plus 1. Therefore, in the quotient ring, fx and rx have the same image. And what is rx now? Rx is of degree less than or equal to 1. So, I can write it as ax plus b, where a and b are in z again. Okay. What happens now? Rx is equal to ax plus b with a and b are in z. What is more? You have x square plus 1 is equal to 0. So, I am going to write it in as bar. The image of x square plus 1 is 0. And what is the image of x? The image of x is just x bar in r by I. And in r by I, this x bar square plus, this is another meaning of the same equation. So, what are we doing? We have got a quotient, quotient by I. If you consider any n in n, which is just an integer, which is also an element of Zx, it is just the constant polynomial n. It will be mapped onto n bar in R by I. And this will be an isomorphism. All of Z will have an image in R by I, which is an isomorphism. You check that, you can check that easily, because different integers will go into different integers, and no integer will be mapped onto 0 bar here. What is the 0 bar? 0 bar is precisely whatever goes into I. No integer will be in I, therefore all these integers map into different integers. So, you get an isomorphic image of z here, and the image of x bar satisfies this. X bar square plus 1 bar is equal to 0. So, x bar does the duty of I. I square is equal to minus 1, or I square plus 1 is equal to 0. So, basically this is the ring which is a kind of extension of Z with I added to it, and that I is precisely the image of X bar